very good afternoon to everyone present here. I am Shri Lakshmi Karampuri, a first year BBA LLB student, and I welcome you all to the webinar on development in corporate law from beginning till date and its impact on the Indian economy being organized by DME Law School. Today, we have with us as chief guest, Professor Dr. KVS Sarma, Vice Chancellor, Maharashtra National Law University, Aurangabad, who has taken time off his busy schedule to deliver this lecture for us. We welcome you, sir. I would also like to extend a warm welcome to Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavan Singh, sir, Director General, Delhi Metropolitan Education, Noida, and former Judge, Allahabad High Court, who is the guiding light for all of us. I further welcome Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami, sir, Director DME, and Professor Dr. Bhavish Gupta, sir, Head of Academics, DME Law School, to the event. I welcome all the participants, and I'm sure that today's event will help everyone present here in enriching their experience and gaining valuable knowledge on this theme. Today, we are extremely honored to have with us the visionary scholar of law, Professor Dr. KVS Sarma, Vice Chancellor, Maharashtra National Law University, Aurangabad, as the chief guest of this event. I would now request Dr. Garima Goswami, ma'am, Associate Professor, DME Law School, to introduce him. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Sri Lakshmi. Good afternoon to all present. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce our guest speaker for today's Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer Memorial Lecture, Professor Dr. KVS Sarma. Professor Sarma was appointed as a Vice Chancellor of Maharashtra National Law University, Aurangabad on 20th August 2019. Sir has secured PhD degree from Behrampur University in the year 2000. Sir started his teaching career from April 1989. Yes. Professor Sarma has a rich experience of working as a law faculty in various law colleges across the country. Sir has also worked as a registrar of Azhar University of Law, Hyderabad. Professor Sarma is also associated with PSC in different capacities. Sir has held Consumer Law Chair Professor post under Ministry of Consumer Affairs, New Delhi, in Al-Azhar University of Law. Professor Sarma has guided more than 100 LLM dissertations, and many scholars have secured PhDs under his able guidance. Sir is also a member of the Standing Committee of Legal Education of the Bar Council of India. It is our honor to have you as our guest, sir. I am sure we will be enriched by this webinar. Once again, I welcome you and we look forward to hear from you. Over to you, sir.
You are not audible?
Sir, you are audible. Something?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
What is their side or our side?
Sir, can you hear us? Sir, we can hear you, sir, if you can hear us.
You tell them, they are not audible, you tell them. Call. You tell them they are not audible. I'm not saying anything.
You are not audible from there.
Even visible also.
And not visible also.
Sir is just rejoining in a minute.
Ji. Good afternoon, DG sir.
Good afternoon.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Director sir is also here. What happened with your duty faculty?
Sure, sir. I'll do that.
लिख दीजिए उसमें एज पर दी इंस्ट्रक्शन.
Sir, can you hear us?
Yes, madam. Yes, yes, yes.
Sir, we cannot see you on screen, sir. If you could please switch on your camera.
I'm on the screen, madam. I'm on the screen. Here I am seeing myself.
So we are unable to see you. We can hear you.
I'm able to see myself in my computer.
Sir, might be your camera is off.
Camera is off.
Camera is
also on.
It may be a bandwidth issue also, maybe internet.
Ma'am, but we are not receiving anything. And we have also two.
What is the problem?
Some internet issue?
Yes, sir. So I'm just contacting them.
Ji, please.
So he has rejoined.
Okay. Thank you, Garima. You have for that. Now I think faculties are joining.
Yes, sir. They're joining.
Sir, sir, we can hear you, sir.
You are able to hear me, madam?
Yes, sir. Very much.
You are able to see?
Not
quite. Video.
Not the video, sir, but we can hear you.
Yes. Video here, I'm getting.
Sir, maybe it's a bandwidth issue thing.
No, but my IT person is also here. Two IT persons are here.
Okay.
They are also helping me. But they are also unable to detect what happened because I am able to see myself on the screen here.
Another participant
is also. All participants I am able to see.
That's
that is on.
Sir, if you can log out and re-log in, then that might do something, I think, sir.
We did 3 times.
Almost 3 times we did, anyhow. Again, you know.
Or you can begin with, and the IT people can in the meantime.
Okay, sir.
Fine.
Right. So I believe he has locked out again. Maybe this time we'll just begin.
Can I start, madam?
Yes, sir. So now you're visible okay. as well as audible, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Namaste, Lordship. Namaste, sir.
Good afternoon. You are very much welcome.
Thank you, Lordship. Thank you. Thank you. I'm starting, madam.
Yes, Honorable, sir, please, sir.
Yes, sir. Honorable Sri Justice Bhavar Singh, Judge, Allahabad High Court, and Director General, DME, New Delhi, respected Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami, Director, DME, New Delhi, respected Professor Bhavish Gupta, Head of the Department, DME, New Delhi, respected faculty members, and my dear students. This today's topic is development in corporate law and its impact on the Indian economy. First of all, I am thankful to the management of DME Society for inviting me to deliver a lecture. That is Justice Krishna, as an eminent judge. Justice V.R. Krishna, yes. I met him 5 to 6 times in Nalsa. When I was working in Nalsa, Lordship came and he participated as chief guest in 6 seminars. At the age of 80, I think, he was so active. And rare quality in Justice Krishna is normally a person may be a judge or a good judge, eminent judge, a person may be an eminent executive, or a person may be an eminent, what you call, advocate, but he is the combination of all three. He was an eminent politician, and he was an eminent executive, minister, able minister, and he was an eminent judge. And more than that, he was more than an English professor. His judgments to understand a common man, very, very difficult. Ordinary person like me, I can't understand Justice Krishna's judgments. To understand his judgment, I have to keep some 10 dictionaries. So many complicated English words, which I never heard. Those type of words Lordship was using. And when I discussed with English professors in Hyderabad, they said, he also cannot understand this. This is so complicated word. We have to refer dictionary, they said. So he was the combination of so many, not one, two. And that type of eminent person's memory, I am delivering lecture means it is an honor. First of all, I am thankful, and I express my gratitude to the management of DME for giving this particular opportunity. And there are three legal systems in the world: civil law system, common law system, and religious law. And common law system means it is mainly based on precedents, that is, judgments of Court of Appeal or House of Lords, now judgments of Supreme Court in UK. In India also, High Court and Supreme Court judgments, they are also part and parcel of law, and judges are having power to interpret the section and identify a new principle. And that principle becomes law and binding on all lower courts in the country. So, common law means judgment law. Civil law means parliament is supreme or body politic is supreme. Religious law, you know, like religious countries, the Islamic countries, for them, Quran is the final, and whatever religious text says, that is final for them. And India is a commonwealth country. So we were ruled by Britishers for more than 200 years. And whatever the majority laws, even our Indian Penal Code 1860, drafted by Lord Macaulay, 1860, even today, no changes in that. So perfectly he drafted, only minor amendments. Your Indian Contract Act 1872, so minor amendments, your Transfer of Property Act, your Evidence Act, take all substantive laws which we are dealing with today in our legal education also. They were framed in, they were passed in British Parliament. And after getting independence, we adopted all those particular laws. And that's why even today we teach Roman principles in contracts. First year students, you study ex turpi causa non auditor actio, ex dolo melo non auditor actio, and law of insurance, law of contracts, and law of torts. These three are based on one Latin maxim: injure non remota causa sed proxima spectatum. That is, in law, the immediate cause, but not the remote cause, should be taken into consideration. There are so many Latin maxims we teach, even today.
Similarly, when we teach any law subjects, first we teach English cases. Then we teach Indian cases. When I studied 1983 my law in SK University, my professor, he taught me Balfour versus Balfour in contracts, Solomon versus Solomon, Ashbury railway carriage. Even today we are teaching these cases. Why we have to teach 1850, 1870 cases even today? Because those principles, even today we are following and applying in our Indian cases. That's why English law is the basis for Indian law. Roman law is the basis for English law. That's why even today we teach Roman principles and Latin maxims and English cases. For example, in company law teacher, he teaches or she teaches independent legal existence, separate personality. For that, the authority we teach was Solomon versus Solomon, House of Plantation. But even prior to that case, Ree Kondalli Tea Company Limited, that separate personality was recognized. But even then, we teach Solomon versus Solomon. In Contract Act, that is intention to create legal relations. In 1850, Lord Atkinson, he identified this principle. The terms of an offer must be intended to create or capable of creating legal relations. Even today we teach. Because Indian Contract Act was passed in the year 1872. Before 1872, in presidency terms, the courts were applying, that is, with the personal law of the defendant. And in provincial terms, the courts were applying justice, equity, and good conscience, equity principles. And each court on similar set of facts, courts were giving different principles, different judgments. So British has thought better to give a codified law to these persons. And they drafted the code, that is Indian Contract Act 1872. It consists of 266 sections and divided into 11 chapters. Then in the preamble of the act, they said, whereas it is expedient to consolidate and remit certain parts of the law relating to contract, means this too, Indian Contract Act is not exhaustive. Wherever gaps are there, you follow our principles. In England, even today, law of contracts is not codified. IPC is not codified. The law of crimes is not codified. We have codified law. They don't have codified law. But even today, R versus Tolson, R versus Prince, like that English cases we are discussing, even in courts also, advocates were arguing and judges were applying those principles even today. The reason is, English law is the basis for Indian law, and why we have to discuss Indian Contract Act when we are taking Indian Companies Act, because Companies Act is also a special contract. Allotment of share is nothing but a special contract. That's why Indian Contract Act principles we have to apply, formation, discharge, remedies, damages, all these principles we have to apply. So Indian Companies Act is also a special contract. So these three, that's why before discussing Indian company law, we have to discuss briefly about English company law. If there are three types of companies which can be formed. First one is chartered company by passing a royal charter in the British Parliament. East India Company, that is in 1600, they passed. And statutory companies, that is SEBI, IRDA, all these are statutory companies. Registered companies, that is a company registered under Companies Act, that is maybe either public company or a private company. These are called registered companies. Now we don't have chartered companies in India. And with reference to English law, the first act was passed in the year English Companies Act 1844, first act. Then in that act, the limited liability principle was not recognized. And this Limited Liability Act they passed 1855. This particular act introduced limited liability principle. So because of limited liability, the people are able to collect huge funds and they are doing business in large scale. If a person can do business in three ways, sole trading, partnership, and company form. And the sole trading concern, the main disadvantage is unlimited liability. In case of partnership, it is not only unlimited, but also joint and several. The main advantage of doing business in the form of a company is limited liability, that is Limited Liability Act 1855 recognized. But who invented the principle limited? Lord Bramble, he invented this principle, limited liability. In case you do business with limited liability, you can attract more funds, and rich man and a poor man also can invest their investments, their savings in corporate sector in same project and can do business. And Lord Bramwell, he was so enthusiastic for this world. We can say that Lord Bramwell may be the father of company law. This Lord Bramwell was so enthusiastic for this world. Just before his death, he executed a will. In that will, he requested his aides, after my death, anyhow, you are going to construct a tombstone. On the tombstone, you are going to write Lord Bramwell, date of birth, date of death. Please write the word limited. If you go and see in London, Lord Bramwell's tombstone, you can see the word limited. So we can say Lord Bramwell is the father of company law. And after 1844 Act, they repealed this and they passed 1856 Act, English Companies Act 1856. Then they passed 1862 Act. Then 1862 Act also was repealed by 1929 Act. Then 1929 Act was repealed by 1948 Act. Then 1948 Act was repealed by 1985 Act. Presently in England, they are following English Companies Act 2006. It came into effect, it came into force in 2009. This is the history of English company law. Now let us come to Indian company law. In India, the first act was passed in the year 1850, Joint Stock Companies Act 1850. This is based on, that is, English Companies Act 1844. If you see Companies Act 1844 and Joint Stock Companies Act 1850, it is nothing but two photocopy. That's why, if you see, then they have 56 Act, 1856. Similarly, in India, whenever they repealed and passed new law, here in India also we used to repeal and pass. And on same lines, we used to draft. So in India, first act was Joint Stock Companies Act 1850. Then Joint Stock, that is Companies Act 1857. Then eight Companies Act 1862. Then Companies Act 1913. Then 1929, so many amendments they made. But after independence, the central government constituted H.C. Baba Committee. And the Baba Committee submitted a report. On the basis of that report, in India, they passed an act, a new act, Indian Companies Act 1956. This act was there till 2013. And if you see English Companies Act 1948, and English company, Indian Companies Act 1956, it is nothing but true photocopy of English Companies Act 1948. That's why Sahare, a professor, eminent professor, who wrote a book on company law, he mentioned in his book, our Indian Companies Act or any other act, they are the most cherished children of English brains. He said, English laws only we are following, almost. So if you, and after 1956, in 1985, they passed one act. Then we wanted to follow that 1985 Act. Meanwhile, P.V. Narasimha Rao in 1991, he started liberalization policies. And they have to change our economic laws also. So in they drafted a bill, Company Law Bill 1993. Then P.V. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister. He was unable to pass that bill in Rajya Sabha because he was not having an absolute majority. Then he was unable to pass this. Then in 1997, again, they prepared a bill, Company Law Bill 1997. Then Prime Minister Devagowda and Prime Minister Gujral were there. They were also not having absolute majority in Rajya Sabha. They were unable to pass this 1997 bill. Then in 2000, central government prepared a concept paper to pass new law. Then the central government constituted an Irani committee. That Irani committee submitted a report. Who is this Irani? He passed MSc. He joined as class one officer in Tata Group. Then he became CEO. Our central government asked a scientist to prepare a draft on company law. Till 1980s, law commission and all laws were drafted by eminent judges, eminent advocates, eminent professors. After 90s, the government started asking industrialists, NGOs, non-law persons, to draft the laws. And we are supposed to go through, we are supposed to teach the students, and these laws were supposed to be argued by advocates, and these laws, the judges have to apply. But almost all laws you see, economic laws, they were drafted by other than law persons. That's why every year, that's why Companies Act 2013, it came into force in the year 2017. Competition Act 2002, it came into force in 2009. So several, and every year they are amending. If you see the old acts, no amendments. So perfectly they drafted. And complicated words they are using, academic terms, all this. They are not giving explanations, they are not giving examples. And simply they drafted. And I came to know that the SEBI regulations, particularly venture capital regulations, were drafted by IIT graduates. And those regulations we are supposed to teach. Your competition law, all economic laws, this is the problem that we are facing today with reference to drafting of laws. So this company law bill, new company law 2013 is mainly based on Irani committee report, and with great difficulty, they passed so many bills, 2003, 2005, like that. At when Rajesh Pilot was the the minister, then he introduced in 2013, and the Companies Act 2013 was passed in Parliament, Lok Sabha, and Rajya Sabha, and it came into force completely in 2017. So this is the history of what you call our Indian company law. And what is the difference between English Companies Act 2006 and Indian Companies Act 2013? Actually, if you see English Companies Act 1985, it consists of some 600 and odd sections. If you see Companies Act 2006, English Companies Act 2006, they doubled the sections, almost 1300 sections. Here, we deviated from English law. If you see Indian Companies Act 1956, it consists of 658 sections. If you see the Companies Act 2013, it consists of 470 sections. They reduced almost 658 to 470. And out of 470 sections, more than 370 sections are ended with as may be prescribed. As may be prescribed is rulemaking power. And what is the difference between Companies Act 1956 and Companies Act 2013? Companies Act 1956 is self-contained. You need not refer any other. But whereas this particular Companies Act 2013 is not self-contained, for everything you have to depend on rules. You are aware that the act is passed in the parliament and there are two sections in every parent act, power to make rules and power to make regulations. That is, rules are framed by the executive, regulations are framed by the statutory body. Ministry of Corporate Affairs will frame rules, Ministry of Finance frame rules, Ministry of Industry frame rules. Regulations are framed by RBI, IRDA, or SEBI, or UGC, or university. All these are regulations. And power to make rules and regulations, and these rules and regulations must be laid before Parliament, if it is Central Act, if it is State Act, before Assembly, when it is in session for 60 days. That's term, another section says. So, out of 470 sections, 370 sections are ended with as may be prescribed. Now, if we teach only Companies Act, what you call 2013, that is not sufficient. For every chapter, corresponding rules are there, rules chapter. We have to teach sections. That's a particular chapter. It is like CPC, sections and orders. CPC consists of 151 sections, 158 sections, and 51 orders. What is the difference between section and order? Sections deal with policy matters, orders deal with detailed procedures. Sections can be amended by the sections must be amended by the parliament. Orders can be amended by the respective high courts. So here, if we go through only the act, that is not sufficient. We have to go through day to day. Any amendments are there in the rules. So we have to go through this and what you call rules also. That is the difference between 56 Act and 2013 Act. 56 Act is self-contained, whereas 2013 Act is not self-contained. And till 1992, if you take, there are, I think, first year students are there, second year students are there. They are not going to study this company law. Those students who are studying fourth year and fifth year only can understand what I am saying now. There is what is the difference between private company and public company? Private company is defined in the act. There are three restrictions it laid. Public company means any company which is not a private company is called public company. main power is given to the public companies. It can raise funds by issuing an advertisement in the newspaper, by issuing prospectus. It can raise funds. It can issue shares. It can issue debentures. And it can request the public to apply for company shares or debentures by issuing prospectus to the general public. But the private company cannot issue prospectus, must not issue prospectus. It has to, under the old Act, 50 members maximum. Under the new Act, 200 members. Maximum for 200 members, it can write letters. And it can allot shares through personal contacts, it can sell. It can sell. So before 1992, a public company, if it wants to raise funds, simply there was one act called Controller of Capital Issues Act 1947. And there was one government authority, Controller of Capital Issues. Just the company was informing that the Controller of Capital Issues, and it was issuing prospectus to the public, and it was collecting money from the public. The company need not, promoters need not invest a single NP also. They were entitled to do business with public money. If same situation is there before when Dhirubhai Ambani starts his business life, difficult for Dhirubhai Ambani to establish this much empire. In those days, without investing single NP, he issued prospectors and he attracted some 100 times or 200 times of more than the, what you call, issued capital, public issue. And with public money, he started the business. LML Vespa Scooters, it issued prospectus in 1983 and it collected more than 100 times of the issued capital, and it returned the money or not, that is leisurely. It started its manufacturing process in 1988. Today, it is not possible. One cannot do business by issuing prospectus immediately after incorporation. So this Control of Capital Issues Act 1947 is there. And because of this loose administration, so many corporate frauds happened, and Harshad Mehta scam like that. So our Indian government, central government, passed one act called SEBI Act, that is Securities Exchange Board of India Act 1992. The main object of SEBI, Securities Exchange Board of India, is to protect the interest of investors, is to protect the interest of investors in corporate securities. And so many, what you call SEBI framed so many regulations. Now to teach company law, to teach banking law is not so easy. To read company law is not so easy. To practice company law or any economic law is not so easy. Previously, only Companies Act we were. Now you have to read Companies Act, you have to read the rules, you have to go through so many regulations. Day to day, every day they are changing these regulations. You must depend on website, you can't depend on textbooks or commentaries, printed books, hard copy. You have to depend on SEBI website only. Day to day you have to see. So with reference to SEBI, prescribed so many stringent regulations to issue prospectus to do business with public money now. So SEBI is there. And before 1992, the companies were listing its securities with stock exchanges. The stock exchange means the place where securities are traded, Bombay Stock Exchange, then National Stock, like that. So many stock exchanges were there. And the stock exchanges were governed by a special act called Securities Contract Regulation Act 1956. Securities Contract Regulation Act 1956. The government framed rules, Securities Contract Rules 1957. So this stock exchanges, the person can list, and till 1988, listing of securities were not mandatory. It was optional. The company was not bound to list. It was not bound to apply to any stock exchange for listing public companies when they issue prospectus. This is one main drawback before 1988. Then Companies Amendment Act 1988, under the 56 Act, I am telling, it made listing compulsory. Whenever any public company wants to raise funds by issuing prospectus to general public, first of all, it has to apply to at least one recognized stock exchange. There were 23 stock exchanges at one time. Now, because of demutualization, so many stock exchanges, they closed. And it should apply to at least one recognized stock exchange. And it should obtain permission from the stock exchange to list its securities. If stock exchange refused permission, the company was not entitled to allot shares to the share applicants. And one more principle they prescribe, that is, when a company applies to three stock exchanges, it should apply permission, it should get permission from three stock exchanges. When it applied to 10 stock exchanges, it should obtain permission from all 10 stock exchanges. Even single stock exchange refused permission, allotment was become void. That was the rule. But with reference to that aspect, if you see the latest Companies Act 2013 and the rules, this is silent. And one company secretary wrote an article and it was published in Computer Law Journal. He cited so many rules, nearly 60 to 70 rules. He said these rules are ultra vires the sections. Rules are ultra vires the sections, he said. And he cited also that. That article, please go through if you get the company secretary practicing, he wrote. Then, with reference to listing, now also it is compulsory, but whether you should obtain permission from all or not, rule is silent, act is silent. Now, similar to this, if you see in US, they have Securities Exchange Act 1934. In US, they passed similar to SEBI in 1934. We passed a similar law in 1992, and they have what we call Securities Exchange Commission, SEC. Like SEBI, they passed in, they established in 1934. Till 1992, we did not do that. If you see in UK, they have this Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002 and Securities and Investment Board. They have, like SEBI, Investment Board. And they have this Financial Service Act 1986. Financial Service Act similar to our SEBI. And this Financial Service Act, it established the Securities and Investment Board. And because of some difficulties, they divided the Securities Investment Board into two parts. That is, divide Financial Conduct Authority, Financial Conduct Authority, and Prudential Regulatory Authority of Bank of England. Like that, they divided banking and this. At one time, initially, they clubbed all three into one. They thought it was difficult to manage and divide, they divided these two regulators into two parts. Then, Financial Services and Markets Act 2000, they passed, with, similar to our SEBI in UK. Then, we have this SEBI, what we call, classified companies into two types. Public companies. Private company, that is not, SEBI is not regulating private companies. SEBI is regulating only public companies. Then what type of public company it is regulating? So it classified public companies into two types. That is, closely held company, widely held public company. Closely held public company means a public company without issuing prospectus to general public, it can allot shares. That is called a closely held public company. And with reference to that particular company, our SEBI Act regulations are not applicable. Widely held public company means by issuing prospectus to general public, when a company raises funds, it is called widely held public company. And after 1988, widely held public company securities must be listed with stock exchanges. So SEBI regulation, SEBI Act is applicable only to listed companies. This is one important change they made after 1992. Now, overall administration of Companies Act is vested with central government. And before 2000, there was one department called Department of Company Affairs. Normally, it was attached to Ministry of Law, Justice, and Company Affairs. And the Department of Company Affairs was headed by a secretary. And the country was divided into four regions, that is Southern, Northern, Eastern, Western. And each region is controlled by one regional director. And each state is controlled by one ROC, Registrar of Companies. And all, suppose the registered office of a particular company is in, let us think, in Bombay. Then he has to file that application with ROC of Maharashtra. That is Bombay only he has to file. Suppose registered office of a company is situated in Madras. He has to file that application in ROC Madras. Like that, where the address of registered office is situated, in that particular register of companies, particular state, the company has to file all its official documents that ROC used to maintain. Then this ROC is controlled by regional directors. Regional director is controlled by what we call the secretary. This particular department was controlled by sometimes Ministry of Labor, Ministry of Industry, and Ministry of Law. Whoever was powerful, that minister was taking this particular department. And there was a conflict between, if you see this SEBI or IRDA or what we call this RBI, all these are controlled by Ministry of Finance. They are attached to Ministry of Finance. SEBI is supposed to control listed companies. Whereas we have Department of Company Affairs till 2003. This was controlled by Department of Company Affairs, Ministry of Law. And there was a conflict between Ministry of Department of Company Affairs and Ministry of Law and Ministry of Finance, because Ministry of Finance was passing some rules. Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Department of Company Affairs was passing some rules, and this rule may be in conflict with the other rule, and conflict was there because two ministries are different, and listed companies were controlled by Ministry of Finance. That is the problem. So in 2003, they established a separate ministry called Ministry of Company Affairs, and they converted that Ministry of Company Affairs into Ministry of Corporate Affairs in 2008. Premjit Gupta was the first minister for state. He was the Company Affairs Minister. But after this government, present government came, the former union leading lawyer and Arun Mr. Jetley, he was Minister of Finance and Ministry of Corporate Affairs. This present government is giving both ministries to one person only to avoid this conflict. If you see yesterday, also Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman was a Minister for Finance and Minister of Corporate Affairs. These two ministries are attached to one person only, so that in order to avoid conflict, a smooth administration, they are doing like this. But after 2013, they increased these regions into 7 regions: Eastern region, Kolkata; Southern region, Chennai; Northern region, Delhi; Western region, Mumbai; Northwestern region, Ahmedabad; Southeastern region, Hyderabad; Northeastern region, Guwahati. So 3 more regions, 3 more RDs they increased. And the ROCs working in those areas are attached to, and those companies also were controlled by that particular RD. Now, when the situation is like this, this Ministry of Company Affairs and Ministry of Corporate Affairs, we teach company law, we teach corporate law. What is the difference between company law and corporate law? Company law means only Companies Act. Corporate law means now we are teaching corporate law, not company law. If you teach only company law to the students, that student can't survive in the field tomorrow, practical side. We have to teach corporate law. Invariably, we have to teach along with Companies Act, we have to teach SEBI Act, we have to teach Depositories Act, we have to teach FEMA, Foreign Exchange Management Act, we have to teach Competition Act. So many other allied laws we have to teach along with Companies Act. Otherwise, the student can't deal company law matters before the courts, or he can't advise the client properly. So corporate affairs, corporate law means it includes so many other connected areas also, laws also. And Ministry of Corporate Affairs was established in 2007. Now the Ministry of Corporate Affairs is controlling the total country. Then Ministry of Finance, already we discussed that Ministry of Finance jurisdiction is to control SEBI and all these IRDA banking. And listed companies are controlled by Ministry of Finance. Unlisted and private companies act is applicable to all companies, but mainly it is controlling what we call unlisted companies. And this is one area, gray area. Normally, SEBI also should be given to, my opinion, to Ministry of Corporate Affairs in order to avoid all these complications. Now, what is the jurisdiction of Ministry of Corporate Affairs? It is regulating Companies Act 2013. Limited Liability Partnership, that is LLP Act 2008, Limited Liability Partnership Act, IBC it is controlling 2016, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, then Competition Act 2002, then Partnership Act 1932, then Chartered Accountant Act 1949, ICWA Cost Accountants Act 1959, then Company Secretaries 1980, Societies Registration Act 1860, then Companies Donation to National Funds Act 1951. These acts, Ministry of Corporate Affairs is regulating. and Minister of Finance mainly dealing with SEBI, IRDA and RBI. And there was a conflict between sometime back, 4 or 5 years back, SEBI and IRDA. SEBI is controlling what we call companies, and IRDA is controlling insurance companies. And now the distinction between banking company, insurance company, and what you call company, registered under Companies Act, appears to be blurred. Insurance companies are also issuing unit linked policies. Then RBI, the banks are also issuing prospectus. Now, bank should be governed by our Companies Act or not, means it should be governed by Ministry of Corporate Affairs. And it should follow Companies Act also wherever parent act is silent. The Companies Act 2013 is applicable. Similarly, insurance companies started issuing ULIPs, and they were not taking, they did not take permission from SEBI. Then SEBI issued an order these insurance companies cannot issue these ULIPs because it amounts to public issue. You should take permission from the SEBI. There was a conflict between these two. Then the matter went up to Ministry of Finance. Then Ministry of Finance said, for the time being, you don't interfere with insurance companies. And they did not settle the matter. And they asked SEBI not to interfere with insurance companies when they issue any securities like that to the public issue. So this is one, what you call ambiguity is there between when you attach the same type of organizations with two different ministries. Then with reference to this clubbing of like Financial Service Authority Act. In India, we are planning to pass International Financial Services, what you call Centers Authority Bill 2019. International Financial Services Centers Authority Bill 2019. This bill already passed in Lok Sabha. They have to pass this in Rajya Sabha. Once they pass this bill, RBI, SEBI, IRDA, pension fund, all these will come under the jurisdiction of this particular act. Then a person to teach this particular company law or economic laws, he has to be thorough with banking, capital markets, insurance, pension funds also. These four will come under this. Already in England, they failed by clubbing all this. Again, they divided in two parts. We saw that even then we want to put all these four into one, and a single authority has to control. Now when there are different authorities, they are unable to. Now single authority, how far that particular what you call committee can control this, I have my own doubts. Then with reference to SEBI Act, Depositories Act, they passed 1996. What is this Depositories Act 1996? Till 1996, companies were allotting shares, debentures by way of paper document. Certificates they were giving, papers, like our degree certificates. Tomorrow we need not carry degree certificates. Depository is there. In the depository, you can now your driving license, everything mobile you are showing to the RTA, the traffic police. Like that, there is one depository, national depository system is there. In that we have to, all universities can keep the certificates. Then anyone wants to, they can check that depository, they keep the number, everything they will get. Like that, in DMAT form, electronic form, under the Depositories Act, the company should allot shares. Prior to 2013, it was not mandatory. Those companies which were issuing more than 10 lakh rupee shares, those companies only were bound to issue shares and debentures in DMAT form, in electronic form. But under 2013 Act, even a company issues one share, it should allot that particular share in DMAT form. Now it is going to make it mandatory even for private companies. Actually, this is applicable only to listed. Now they are planning to make it mandatory for private company shares and debentures and all other securities also. So this one more peculiar thing, when you transfer a share document, a paper document, you have to pay a stamp duty to the government. Now 1996 to 2002, electronic form they were transferring and they were not paying stamp duty to the government. And governments also did not realize. Then they amended the Finance Act in 2002 and 0.25% securities transaction tax they imposed. So for a period of almost 6 years, government lost huge revenue on this transaction, securities transaction. Then SEBI passed some guidelines, that is SEBI Disclosure and Protection Guidelines 2000. SEBI Act was passed in 1992. Till 2000, with reference to public issues, company has to make some disclosures. Those disclosures, with reference to those disclosures, the company, the SEBI issued so many guidelines. These guidelines were scattered, not in one place. Every day, in those days, websites internet was also not properly supplied to the public. And in those days, how practitioners were doing their practice, I don't know. 92 to 2000, and they were passing so many guidelines. Every public issue, public company, when it issued prospectus, it should follow those guidelines. The persons who drafted those guidelines were not having legal knowledge. That's why, if you see on 11th June 1992, first time they passed one guideline, you can see this guideline in Ramayya's Companies Act 1992 edition. The SEBI says, if anyone violates the guidelines issued by SEBI, SEBI can institute criminal proceedings. How? For violation of regulations, parliament sanctity is there, rules, parliament sanctity is there, act, parliament permission sanctity is there, approval, guidelines are not approval. Guidelines are not approved by the parliament, but they pass that guideline. It can institute criminal proceeding and imprisonment. That when someone guided them, I think SEBI officials, they omitted the guideline. This is the problem in case non-law persons, if they draft, they can take the help from other than law persons, but the main drafting duty should be given to the legal person, then only laws will be drafted effectively. So, with reference to all these guidelines were codified as SEBI Disclosure and Protection Guidelines 2000. They divided this into 11 chapters, almost 111 guidelines they framed. Then these guidelines were not enforceable in case any company violates. Then they converted these guidelines into regulations. SEBI Issue of Capital and Disclosure Requirements Regulations 2009. Now regulations are enforceable in the court of law because parliament approval was there. Then what they did, this regulations also 2009, they repealed, they passed now SEBI Issue of Capital and Disclosure Requirement Regulations 2018. When I was teaching 2000, one of my student, LLM students, simply she said, sir, this regulations 2009 repealed. SEBI passed 2018. It is not there in any book. They have to depend on Act and Mobile, she showed. But notification, they did not issue. Notification they issued after 3-4 months. But even then, we can't teach 2009 in 3-4 months when these regulations were repealed. Students, when they go out, they are supposed to follow 2018 regulations. So again, this issue switched over to new regulations, even though notification was not issued. That is one advantage of national law schools. We can switch over immediately. That is not possible for state universities or any university affiliated to state. They have to, they can't teach. Whenever any law is 6 months gap should be there like that, some guidance is there. So they can't teach. Any amendment is there, immediately they can't go to that amendment unless and until Board of Studies approves. This is one advantage in national law schools. They can go to new law immediately, even though notification is not issued. They can, like our new labor code, notification is not issued. But in my university and some law schools we are teaching, because by the time the students go out, they have to study new law only. Almost rules are drafted. So if you teach old law, there is no purpose. Industrial dispute 1947, 1926 Act, if you teach, what is the use? We have to teach new labor code, even though notification is not issued. But that power, discretion is not there to any universities, private universities, or colleges attached to state universities. So 2018 regulations they passed. Then we have this listing agreement. This is one important listing agreement. What is this listing agreement? It consists of almost 50 clauses. And clause 49 of listing agreement is dealing with corporate governance. There is a difference between company administration, corporate administration, and corporate governance. Company administration deals with legal issues. corporate governance deals with ethical issues. So this corporate governance was discussed in class 49 of listing agreement. This listing agreement came into force. They prepared and came into force in 2005, listing agreement first time. Then this class 49, they omitted, they repeat, and the corporate governance principles and listing obligations were incorporated in SEBI listing obligations and disclosure requirement regulations 2015. Now 2015 regulations is dealing with listing aspects and corporate governance principles. And the SEBI introduced so many intermediaries. And it says to start a business, a public company must do business for 5 years. Its net worth must be this much. It should earn profits, net profits from last 5 years. And it should declare a dividend last 5 years. Then only that company should go for public issuing. There are so many stringent rules it prescribed. In addition to that, a public company cannot directly issue prospectus. It has to appoint so many intermediaries. And these intermediaries are linked between the investor and the company. And these intermediaries, with reference to these intermediaries like advocate. If you want to argue directly, a client can argue his own case in any court, even in Supreme Court. A person can argue his own case. But a person wants to argue another person's case, in consumer fora, it is permitted. Power of attorney can be given. That power of attorney can be given, that particular person can argue the case of another person also in state commission or national commission or district forum because of Supreme Court judgment. But with reference to other matters, I can't argue other person's case unless I have law qualification. I'm an advocate. Like that, if you want to issue, you have to appoint so many intermediaries, and these persons must fulfill the regulations prescribed by SEBI. For each intermediary, regulation SEBI passed. And those requirements it should fulfill and it should register. Like advocates, any company wants to appoint a particular intermediary, it can out of 100, it can take anyone. So many advocates are there, client can go to, like patient can go to any doctor. Like the company can appoint anyone intermediary in that particular category. So what are the various intermediaries? For example, if you see market participants, brokers, underwriters, portfolio managers, and stock exchanges and clearing corporations, then we can see investment advisors, research analysts, then the debenture trustees, merchant bankers, share transfer agent, registrar to an issue, then credit rating agencies. Like that, so many intermediaries it prescribed. And a company can appoint any one of the intermediary. And the merchant banker is the main agent. He will supervise, he will control all other intermediaries, and he will submit all reports to SEBI and to government, to ROC on behalf of the company. And the company should deal with the investor through this particular intermediaries. Now, after 1992, the company cannot directly deal with the investor. It has to deal through all these intermediaries. And with reference to this, two important aspects, SEBI regulations, takeover code, and insider trading. Insider trading regulations 1992, that was repealed in 2015. Now insider trading regulations 2015 is there. According to this, if I'm a director, suppose in the annual meeting, I came to know that the company earned huge profits. Then unless and until this information is given to the public, I cannot deal with. Not only me, any person who is having access to this information should not deal with this company securities. If he deals, it amounts to insider trading, it is a crime and punishable with 25 lakhs or imprisonment up to 10 years. Similarly, takeover. One executive director, SEBI, in one seminar, he told, this Mafatlal Industries, that particular promoters, they started the company. And slowly one day, one person came and said, now I am the owner, I am controlling the company, you get out. What he did, slowly in market, he started purchasing 5%, 5%, 5%. Like that 70% shares he controlled. Later on, he acquired control of board also. So in order to avoid these type of situations, they passed a takeover code regulations 1994, that was repealed by 1997. Then 2011, we have takeover code regulations. Now to purchase shares in securities in listed company, any investor should follow the conditions prescribed by the takeover code regulations 2011. Otherwise, it is an offense. If I purchase any shares in any listed company without following takeover code 2011, then it is an offense, punishable with 10 years imprisonment and 25 lakh rupees fine also. So these two legislations are very important, takeover and insider trading. Then with reference to mergers also, cross-border mergers, with reference to cross-border mergers, Companies Act 1956 was silent. 2013 Act, it provided a section to deal with cross-border mergers also. For that, it has to follow SEBI takeover code regulations, Income Tax Act 1961, then Competition Act. It has to follow the Foreign Exchange Management Act. So many conditions are there. All these conditions, the acquirer company should follow, and then only cross-border acquisition is permitted. And now Competition Act also came into force, 2002. It was passed and it came into force in 2009. This Competition Act is also dealing with combinations. It is also dealing with mergers. The main difference between mergers under competition and mergers under Companies Act, Companies Act is dealing with only mergers with what you call of companies only, of two companies. Whereas Competition Act, Section 5 and 6, is dealing with combination means two individuals, they are doing business. If they want to enter into joint venture agreement, if their joint venture business falls under Section 5 of Competition Act, they should take permission from Competition Commission. If two partnership firms, if they want to do business, and if their joint venture after joint venture falls under Section 5 of Competition Act, they should take Competition Commission permission. Two companies, they should take permission from NCLT, NCLAT. If appeal goes to Supreme Court permission, then Competition Commission permission also. Companies have to take two. If it is a telecommunication company, telecommunication tribunal also, that is multiple, they have to, tribunals permissions they have to take. This is one problem with reference to acquisition of companies. And with reference to government and private partnership, public-private partnership, if it falls under that joint venture, under Section 5, that government and, because Competition Act is governing individuals, firms, for example, Hinduja, they are doing joint family business. If two joint Hindu family business, if they want to join, then if it falls under Section 5, they should take permission from Competition Commission. So, companies, the Competition Act is regulating individuals, firms, companies, enterprises, means government organizations. Then it is regulating joint families, business, not everything, societies, everything it is controlling, this particular Competition Commission. So with reference to competition, if you see in UK, they have Competition Act 1998, they have Enterprises Act 2002. In US, if you see with reference to this, what you call competition law, before 2002, this monopolies, all these were governed by Monopolies Restrictive Trade Practices Act 1969. Under MRTP Act 1969, monopoly per se is bad. Monopoly per se is bad. But under Competition Act, monopoly per se is not bad. Abuse of monopoly is bad. If you abuse, you can acquire monopoly. That is not bad. But if you abuse that monopoly, it is bad, and Competition Commission will come into picture. So with reference to this, they passed acts in US, Sherman's Act 1890, Clayton's Act 1914, then Federal Trade Commission Act 1914. In 1914 only they established, they framed these laws, and almost after 100 years we framed laws with reference to monopoly here. So these are some important laws relating to what we call this company law developments. Now impact of the Indian economy, it will take at least 15 minutes. Already time is 4:10. So I may be excused because all persons are there. I cannot take the time. This itself took almost 1 hour, 10, 15 minutes I lost in the beginning. But I can take this impact of latest changes on Indian economy. It will take 15 minutes, sir. That's why if you allow, I will stop. Otherwise, I will become a trespasser and I will become a criminal also.
Please go ahead.
But all willing, then I can, but lordship is also there. I cannot take lordship's time. And all senior professors are also here. I cannot take their time also. Already time is 4:10. Now it is up to any discussion, question, answers.
Thank you, sir, for the insightful understanding that you shared with us today. Now, we would like to invite questions from the audience. If you have any, you may please direct it towards me in the chat box.
I think, Shrilakshmi, you can proceed with the questions that have come to you.
Yes, ma'am. Sir, with your permission, I would now like to present certain questions posed by the participants.
Please.
The multiplicity of laws like SEBI, SCRA, Companies Act, and its various rules, do you think it has reduced the ease of doing business in India? Or do you feel it is a desirable framework, keeping in mind the investors?
Yes, madam. What you said is different class now is creating confusion. I am accepting Companies Act, SEBI Act, IRD Act, and banking regulation, all these. They are planning to introduce this Financial Services Regulatory Commission Bill. International they use, because international listings also is permitted now. They use the word international. But under the new act, banking, to regulate banking, they constituted one committee. Banking separately they did. But for others, capital markets, insurance, pension, all these one commission only. But under the act, same act, different what we call committees they keep, then they can coordinate and versus single regulatory system is there, but committee should be, like SEBI committee is there, that. Like that in IRDA, IRDA also FX committee is there. Like that, these committees will constitute, because a person who is an expert in insurance may not be an expert in company law. A person who is an expert in corporate law side may not be an expert in pension side. So under the same act, the committees you constitute, and through those committees with single law, and all these committees are controlled by one single head. There may be a chairman, and he can coordinate with all these committees and he can solve the problem. But what in the latest bill they are doing, for banking only one committee they kept. All the remaining areas they kept under one committee only. And that committee may consist of 4-5 persons. When they, 4-5 persons, how they can acquire expertise in all these fields. So that is my apprehension. That's why it failed in UK already. They brought under one head, again they divided into two parts. So, how to wait and see? Capital markets is nothing but trial and error. What SEBI is doing? Today it is passing one law. If it fails, then it is passing new law. So, trial and error method, this is also trial and error. Let us wait and see, madam, whether this single, new bill, if it becomes an act, before it is successful, we will see. If it is successful, well and good. Otherwise, again, let us go back to the old system. We have to wait and see with reference to the single window system, single regulator, these two.
Thank you, sir, for addressing our questions. No institution can run without the presence of a great leader, and we are privileged to have our Director General, Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavar Singh, sir, with us. From his appointment in 1970, His Lordship has had a very illustrious career and has graced the office of the Judge of Special Court of CBI, the Registrar General, Supreme Court of India, and the Judge of Allahabad High Court. He was the part of the bench that heard matters of the historic judgment related to Ayodhya decision. Sir has always been with us, guiding and showing us the right path, and is an inspiration to us all. I would request respected Director General Sir bless us with his inspirational words. Please, sir.
Honorable the Chief Guest, Professor Dr. KVS Sharma, Director Ravikant Swami, Dr. Bhavesh Gupta, HOD, faculty members, organizer Ved Priya and her team members, faculty members, dear students. I'm greatly impressed by the erudite lecture of Dr. Sharma. Indeed, he seems to be the master of this subject. And more, I'm impressed by his comparative terms in the field of the corporate law, particularly the company law, the salient features thereof, and how the SEBI has been working, the examples of UK, United States. It has all made a very interesting subject for discussion this afternoon. My huge compliments to such an eloquent speaker. God bless you. Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, as said by Dr. Sarma, was a great judge of his times. And by all who might have had the opportunity of going through his judgments, would really need a dictionary to be kept by his side or her side. Without dictionary, his judgments cannot be read, and at least cannot be understood. I have been following Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer after he had been elevated to the bench of the Supreme Court. And from the day one, he had established himself in the Supreme Court. He was said to be a communist. And Dr. Sharma also had made a reference in this regard. But he used to say that I was communist by thought. I have never joined the Communist Party. Great. Despite that he was not a member of the Communist Party, the first Communist Party government in Kerala selected him to be a law minister, home minister, and jail minister. Indeed, creditable to the stature of a man of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer. He was a frank speaker. He had no inhibition while expressing his views about any subject, about any judge. He would criticize an erring judge of the Supreme Court, and he did so in the interest of justice. He never meant any prejudice against anyone, but whatever he said, it was indeed for progress of our country, for development of the social laws. And since he was a socialistic in his thoughts, leading to the communism, he perhaps was thinking not in favor of the corporate laws. As I can visualize, and as I can know, and we all, at least the faculty members, can appreciate that without corporate laws, we cannot survive in this modern world. Corporate law. Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer was born, brought up, and practiced in a time when corporate law was slightly away from the modern presentation of these corporate laws. As a matter of fact, he was of the socialistic views. He had always thought of the poor, the downtrodden, and he has mentioned in his memoirs that the students who were his companions in his school and colleges and who belonged to the poor families were not good performers in the class. Right from those days of his schooling, he had started feeling for amelioration of the lot of the poor people. He said, poverty is a curse in India. And he was always thinking and working for the improvement of the lot of the poor people. It was these thoughts of his that Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the then Prime Minister, thought of bringing him to the Supreme Court. And he has written in his interesting anecdotes of his life and career that when Kumar Mangalam, the then Law Minister, he spoke to him that you come to the member of the Law Commission, he refused. He said that, why should I come? Then he was conveyed that perhaps Madam Indira Gandhi had him to be taken to the Supreme Court. Then he insisted that if they want me to be a member of the Supreme Court, then why not directly? But then he was persuaded and he was convinced that he was 104th in the seniority of the then High Court judges, and he would be considered to be a true junior to come to the Supreme Court. So he was brought as he was brought to the Law Commission of India, and he prepared the legal aid scheme there. Not that he simply passed his days so as to wait for becoming the Supreme Court judge, but he justified his presence everywhere. And I remember very profusely that he used to say that it was, when he was at the bar, he used to say that it was never a pleasure to argue before a dull judge. So he always wanted to create a liaison between the judge's understanding and the power of arguments of a brilliant lawyer. Friends, many people of great people, I must say, the judges, the advocates have spoken very high of him. He was a good critic, and he would never feel shy to criticize even the Supreme Court judges. He was in favor of creating a performance commission to watch the working of the Supreme Court judges and the High Court judges. And he would never like the judges who shy to write judgments well in time. Friends, once I was reading one of his article, and you know, the philosophers of all times have been giving their opinion on every topic and every subject, be it a law. Though the philosophers of past times, of the Greek, of Roman, of Rome, and other European countries and Western countries, they were not law graduates, nor they had studied law ever. But they would express as to what the law should be and how the ruler should be guided by the laws which he himself has created. Although the word of a king in those days used to be the rule of law, but the philosophers always kept guiding the rulers as to what laws they should follow on. Friends, once Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer was traveling on the roads of the Cochin, a city where he established himself, where he practiced, where he was a judge, and then after retirement also he has settled there. So he felt very bad of the roads of the Cochin. So he wrote an article, and in this article he said, Cochin city, let me quote, I quote, Cochin city, a traffic chaos, functional anarchy, streets, terrorism, tragedies everywhere, roads, arts, absence, safety, shock, and shame for any corporation. See, he was a critic all through, critic of all those whom he came across. Traffic terrorism was the first word coined by him. And he was a person who could coin any word. He could give a twist to the verbs, to the adverbs, and to the adjectives. Friends, one of the great judges of Australia said that he wrote poetry in his judgments in the shape of prose. What a wonderful observation of the Australian judge. And Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer was himself he would appreciate everyone who was on the right path. He once wrote in his article, Jawaharlal Nehru used to keep on his table the lines of Robert Frost. I quote the lines of the Robert Frost. The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep and miles to go before I sleep. Friends, he was a judge who was never born in the world, I must say, and perhaps is not likely to be born. With this, I give my respectful homage to the great judge and Manu Singhvi's father, great L.M. Singhvi, who had delivered me the first prize when I stood first in the LLM examination in Meerut University. Justice L.M. Singhvi was invited to address the convocation day, and I remember he spoke very well. Once when Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer was retiring, he spoke in his honor at a farewell dinner, and he said, I quote, permit us to remind you that the bar is the judge of judges, and no judge can avoid or escape the verdict of the bar. In a span of a little over 7 years, you have brought distinction to the highest court of the land. Indeed, you did more than that. You opened its doors wider to the poor, the needy, and the indigent, unquote. As a matter of fact, the heart of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer was bleeding for the fundamental rights of the citizens and for the natural rights, which are also called human rights, of the poor. Friends, I'm indeed delighted to be a part of this event where Mr. Dr. Professor K.V.S. Sarma has given a wonderful lecture. We must learn from him, from his lecture, from his observations. And we must, it would be my advice to my faculty members that they must follow the qualities, the virtues of a great leader like Professor K.V.S. Sarma. Professor Sarma, thank you very much. God bless you. You have enlightened us on such a wonderful topic with your great utterances, wonderful utterances on the subject you have taught us. Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your inspirational words. With this, we move on to the end of the event. I would like to invite Ms. Bedapriya Lahiri, ma'am, Assistant Professor, DME Law School, to give vote of thanks. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Sri Lakshmi. I would like to begin by heartily thanking our speaker for today, Professor Dr. K.V.S. Sharma, sir, for sparing time out of his busy schedule for delivering such a knowledgeable address. It was learning not only for the students, sir, but as faculty members too, who learned so much from your lecture today. Thank you so very much, sir. I would also express my profound gratitude to Director General, sir, Honorable Mr. Justice Bhavan Singh, sir, for his blessings. Our Director, Professor Dr. Ravikant Swami, sir, and Head of Academics, Professor Dr. Bhavish Gupta, sir, for their moral support and constant guidance. I would like also like to thank our team for today, Dr. Garima Goswami and the students, Sri Lakshmi and Gunni, for their assistance. And last but not the least, to the participants who actively participated today and were such a wonderful audience. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Your Lordship, permission. Can I leave, Lordship? Can I leave, Lordship? Program is over. Can I leave? Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. So students can stay back and record the attendance. We have reached the end of the session for today. Thank you very much.